Okay, and so this was a reaction and a gas phase reaction of 2A going to B, and again, we should draw this as being reversible. And the question basically dealt with what would happen if you added an inert to that system. And so first we can consider an isothermal case. And this question was phrased such that when you added the inert, you maintained the partial pressure of your reactant initially as being constant, but the total pressure would end up doubling as you increase the amount of dirt and inert to double the total number of moles that you were starting with in this process. All right, so let's see how this would work. And what we're going to want to do is set up an equilibrium expression so that we have our K, which is equal to the mole fraction of B raised to the first power over the mole fraction of A raised to the second power. And this will be multiplied by the pressure to the negative first power, because we're losing one mole as we undergo the reaction of A to B. Okay, and so this is our equilibrium relationship, and we need to plug in for our mole fractions in terms of the extent of reaction. And I'll take a quick shortcut here. All right, and so if we start with a basis of one mole of A, let's say, then, or let's say that we start with one mole of A, then we will form half a mole of B. So we get a 1/2 squiggle for the number of moles of B. And then if we're starting with a mole of A, then it will be 1 minus squiggle will be the number of moles of A that we have left. And we will need to square that. And these are the number of moles of A and B. And so we're going to have a total number of moles that we're dividing by to get the mole fraction. And when we cancel those terms, that total number of moles will be in the numerator, and so we'll have a 1 minus 1/2 squiggle, which is the total number of moles in our system. And so that term's there, right? And we will again have the pressure dependence here. And so in this question, we added the inert to basically double the initial number of moles that we started with, right? So that it would be 2 moles. And so if we make that change, right, then the change in the total number of moles up here is going to be 2. Okay, and the pressure that we start with is also going to be doubled. So this pressure will go up by a factor of 2 initially. All right, and so the question is, which of these effects is going to be greater? And it turns out that if you plug in numbers, you see that this effect is greater. And so if you just make up a number for squiggle and say that it's, for example, 0.5, then the ratio of this number, which is going to be 1.75, right, over the original number when this was 1, which would be 0.75, that's a number that's greater than 2. And so the effect here is actually greater than the effect here. And so adding the inert in the case of an isothermal reaction is going to decrease the extent of reaction because your numerator is increasing, and you therefore need to decrease squiggle in order to compensate for that, when this K is constant because it's an isothermal reaction. And so let's take a look at the case, which is that you have an adiabatic reaction. So now the value of the equilibrium constant can change. And so let's assume that we're dealing with an exothermic reaction. And so we can draw one of our typical diagrams of temperature versus extent of reaction. And we know that qualitatively, this will be our equilibrium line, right, that the equilibrium extent of reaction will decrease with increasing temperature. And we know that for an adiabatic system, we've developed an energy balance that there will be a particular slope where if we enter at the beginning of an adiabatic reaction, we will be here at our inlet temperature, our feed temperature, and the reaction will proceed down this line. And if we let it go infinitely long, then we'll reach equilibrium at this particular position, for example. Okay, so if we add an inert, how does this change? All right, the inert basically will not react, and so its sole function there in a way is to be able to absorb the heat that's generated by the reaction. So that means that the temperature will go up less dramatically when you add this inert, and so it will increase the slope here and allow you to actually achieve potentially higher equilibrium conversion. All right, now the caveat to this is that when you add this inert, all right, and you change this expression for K, that you actually will shift the equilibrium curve slightly to the left. All right, under most situations, that shift would not be enough to compensate for the fact that you're able to achieve this higher extent of conversion. In other words, the shift wouldn't be so far over that your extent of conversion would actually be lower. All right, but it is conceivably possible for this particular example that would be the case. But the main reason that I wanted to have this problem up is really reflected in something that you see in industry. And one of the reasons why you might often want to use inerts is that it does often enable you to get a higher equilibrium extent of conversion because it dampens out the effect of the fact that you're going to be heating up your reaction mixture during an adiabatic reaction, which tends to push you toward lower extent of reaction. And so by dampening that out, you're able to achieve a higher extent of reaction by feeding this inert that, again, the main function of that inert is just to absorb the energy that's being generated by the reaction so that your temperature doesn't increase as much, and therefore your equilibrium constant stays higher for this exothermic process. And the inverse also applies for an endothermic reaction. Then an inert also helps you there by increasing your slope of your energy balance line.